The source becoming all that is, and how it ties into the primer field model of the world, which is the atom, which is the so-called flat earth model. It's not a one-dimensional pancake floating in space. This is a multi-dimensional construct, and the ball, spinning ball world with water sticking to it, that is a three and four-dimensional, low dimension understanding of the world. It's the quite the opposite. That is simplistic. This takes higher dimensional thinking to understand. So you're not a simpleton because you understand the flat earth model. It's the other way around. So imagine that, you have the omnipresent creator. Even scientists don't know how everything came from nothing, okay? But there is no such thing as nothing. There is nothingness, the idea of nothing, but there is always something, or else we wouldn't be here right now. Okay? So let's just say it's consciousness, and what I'm calling it the omnipresence, which pervades everything. The omnipresence, if it is in a state of absolute awareness of all that is, right? It's dreaming reality. And if it wants to focus on a singularity or the self, the individual identity of a self, that's an interesting word, identity, because it's literally showing you I dent, I tie. It's telling you the origins of the torus field. There's an indentation, an implosion, and then the eye of that torus field starts to spin in on itself and tie the Celtic knot, which is and also a representation of this torus field, the spinning Merkaba energy field. This is what you get. You get these spiraling waves that go in a big circle like this when you have vibration. So God moves over the face of the deep, and that's consciousness, awareness, and speaks the word. That's vibration. So when you have vibration, you can't just have this linear vibration that goes out infinitely, or you don't have anything. It will just dissipate. It has to form some kind of a system that collapses in on itself so that it becomes self-aware. It has that self-awareness and its self-sustained system. And that is the torus field that we're talking about. So you have your focal point. The omnipresent mind focuses on that singularity. That singularity creates a ripple in the time continuum, whatever you want to call that, the Akashic field. And it's not a particle. So everybody thinks atoms are proton, neutron, electron, particles. They're waves that are opposing each other. And these waves that oppose each other are spinning one direction, and then the other side is the other direction. And you get this flower of life pattern if you're looking down through the center of it. If you saw a side view of this, you would see this would be the central point of focus, and then as it's spinning, it's going in all directions multidimensionally. You have a flat plane of inertia or accretion disk here where it's the densest, and then from the electromagnetic field is producing all these various states of matter according to its relative position or state, whatever medium it's in. So, from the side view of this, you see the torus field. It looks kind of like a clover leaf, and it's going to fractal infinitely outward, and that's where you get your Om symbol. So, you have to ask, how did the ancients understand this? What an Om symbol was. They had no ability to use models with computers to come up, generate these kind of patterns. So they were tapping into the Akashic field themselves with their consciousness to see these things. Also, if you vibrate a platform at a certain frequency, it will show you this pattern. So, how did they know? How did they know this? This is basically that, but we call this the Adam or the apple. The Appa means father, and the father is the greater consciousness field. So we're inside of this system. experiencing the two-dimensional or one-dimension plane, the flat plane, but we have higher consciousness. So we are bridging heaven and earth and even hell, because we can understand lower dimensional concept as well. And in these lower realms, you're going to have beings that don't have access to the higher consciousness state, to the point where you have your inert plane, which is inert matter that is not animate. It's not an animated moving thing. That's why they call it earth, because that inert is where that word comes from. And also hearth, heart, the center, the core, where energy is transformed. So people think of the core of the earth as a solid ball, but in this model, nothing is actually solid anyway, but you can't just have a dense, solid core of something, because energy has to go somewhere. Otherwise, it would just explode. The hearth, the center of this fleur-de-lis, flower of life pattern, is a heart shape. If you look at the golden ratio symmetry of it. And so this whole system, a friend of mine that lives in Nepal, he told me once that, God was generator, operator, destroyer. That's what the way they think of it, because that's what it is. It's a system of generation, operation from the center, and then just destruction or deconstruction and recycling. Shakti, Shiva. All of these religions, like the Hindu religion, it was science. It was not about worshiping many gods. The many gods were archetypes for these different aspects of creation and consciousness and psychology, even, and the physical body.